Welcome back to After the Fact. A group of former senators joins the growing number of sectors endorsing Vice President Leni Robredo's presidential bid. They say Robredo is the most qualified and trustworthy presidential candidate. But with the late dictator's son, Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr., still leading recent surveys, how can Robredo or other presidential candidates block the return of another Marcos in Malacañang? We're now joined by former Senator Serge Osmeña III, who recently announced his support for Robredo. Good evening, sir, and thank you for joining us on the program.
And thank you for having me.
Okay, first, I'd like to clarify. I remember initially you said you were going to support Mayor Isko Moreno's presidential bid, and now you declared your support for Vice President Robredo. What happened?
Well, when Isko said that he would not allow President Duterte to be investigated by the UN, by the United Nations, I withdrew support on him because that is precisely why we need the United Nations to investigate those people in our country who are doing things that are not good for the people.
You're talking about the ICC?
The ICC.
Okay. But at that time, before that pronouncement was made by Mayor Isko Moreno, had you been somehow helping him already? Perhaps giving advice?
No, I just endorsed him, but I never got to help him.
Okay. Let's go.
I spoke with Lito Banayo only once.
And then?
But they never got in touch with me again.
Okay. So you're supporting Vice President Leni Robredo. So, of course, a very basic question. Why? Of all those running for president?
Well, she's the best qualified among all the candidates for president. That's why. She has a program of government. She's clean. She's honest. She's got energy. And I think that she's going to do a better job than either of them.
Don't you see those attributes, say, with the front runner in the surveys, Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr.?
Oh, no. Not at all. He hasn't done anything at all. I don't know what in his past he has done to make us want to vote for him. He has done nothing as governor. He has done nothing as congressman. And he has done nothing as senator. So why should we vote for him?
So in this case, how do you explain the front-runner status of the former senator? Okay. And in the latest policy survey, 60%, sobrang taas.
Yes, 50 to 60%. You see, since 2013, he got the remnants of the Cambridge Analytica people to do the work for him in social media. So everything in social media has been promoting his father, not him, his father. And so in the latest, FDGs that we've had, etong sinasabi ng mga tao, susundan ang yapak ng ama niya. Kasi dati, tinatawag ng Tiger of Asia ang Pilipinas. So that's okay. One. All right. Second, mayaman tayong bansa dati. Kasi mababa ang presyo ng bilihin.
Okay. Second,
yes. Third, yung kung kay Marcos, Tiger Economia tayo. Number one sa export. Second richest country in Asia.
Okay.
Maraming trabaho. Maganda ang ekonomiya noon kay Marcos. At yung mali naman ng ama niya, gusto niyang itama. So, this last part only refers to Bongbong. But the first four parts refers to the father. So the father's image is about plus 73% now in this country. You know, so it used to be down before. It used to be about 20, 30%. Now it's 73%. So you cannot hit Bongbong because when you hit Bongbong, you're not hitting the father. You should hit the father. And when that comes out, Bongbong will naturally slide.
Okay.
If you don't hit the father, Bongbong will just run away with it.
Okay, kayo po as a veteran political strategist also, no? How do you explain that double standard, that disconnect? Na he's running and is benefiting from the so-called good things done by his father. Pero yung mga napakaraming masamang nagawa, he's being shielded from that. Yes. How to explain that?
Because, you know, martial law happened 36 years ago. So anybody who's about...
50 years ago.
No,
close to 50 this year.
36 from 1986.
From EDSA.
Yeah. So anybody who's about 55 years old has no memories of martial law. None. They were born after, or they were maybe they were 10 years old or 15 years old then. But they have no memories of martial law. So those are the people that he has been able to fool. Okay? Because he's just saying, eto nangyari noon. Maganda ating ekonomiya, maganda yung ating bansa. Now we're the laggard of Asia. That is not true. That is not true. And then we will have to prove that. For example.
Again, there's a lot of disinformation going around, basically trying to paint a rosy image of the late dictator. Even the use of this dictator, the fact that I'm using this term, marami nung magagalit ng mga loyalista, mga blind loyalists on social media. Pero yung idea na ganyan, parang why is he very successful in this regard?
Because, when you have social media repeating the same things year after year, and this is from 2013, 2014, 2015, 2016, 2017, 2018, 2019, 2020, 2021. It will definitely be able to affect a lot of people, particularly the young. And we have to get to those people and tell them, no, that is not true. And this is really what happened during martial law. Never mind Bongbong. Let's leave Bongbong aside for a while. Let us just say, point out what happened during martial law. And when they realize that, then they might change their minds. Now remember, our history books has hardly mentioned anything about martial law. All right? So these guys know nothing about martial law.
Mm.
Now, for example, when you go into the first, when Marcos became president, in 1965, in 2 years' time, he opened already several bank accounts in the United States and Switzerland. And this was found out by Senator Jovito Salonga in his book, all right?
Yeah.
Now, when he declared martial law in 1972, all of a sudden, everybody was put into jail. So there were 70,000 detainees. I was one of them. There were 70,000 detainees. Maybe at that time, there were about, in the first 2-3 years, there were about 30 to 40,000 detainees. Then it started to slacken off, but it reached 70,000 detainees. About 3,200 people were killed. About 24,000 were tortured. So at the same time, in 1972, he gave away everything to his cronies. So sugar went to Bobby Benedicto.
Mm-hmm.
Coconut went to Danding Cuanco. Tobacco went to Lucio Tan. PLDT went to Ramon Cuanco. Meralco went to Cocoy Romualdez. Construction went to Rudy Cuenca. Logging went to Enrile. Pharma went to Joselito Yao Campos. Cars went to Carding Silverio. Philcomsat went to Niling Nieto. Shipbuilding went to Bejo Romualdez. The airline went to Roman Cruz, but Roman was just a front for Imelda. Mm. And bananas went to Tony Floyrendo. And these people, they borrowed so much money. Now, the Philippine government had to guarantee all their loans. Now remember, we had only about $650 million in foreign debt in 1965 or 1972. It went up to 26 billion. Of the 26 billion, he stole 10 billion.
Mm, at least.
When these people, after 1980, they could not pay their loans anymore.
Mm.
So the people, the foreign banks started running after the government because the government guaranteed all their loans. Lahat ng loan nila, loan ni Bobby Benedicto, Cuanco, Lucio Tan, they were all guaranteed by the national government. So what happened? What happened was that our poverty rates went from 30% to 55%. Our poverty rate was 55%. Today it's 15%. Our poverty rate is 55% in 1984. Our certificates on the indebtedness, which is the interest rate, the interest rate that you pay, CBCI, Central Bank Certificate of Indebtedness, went up to 43%. Can you imagine you're borrowing money from the government and it's paying you 43%?
Yeah.
So you can imagine the inflation that happened then.
Yeah. So basically, yan, established fact yan, no? Especially coming from you.
Yes.
A victim of martial law. Pero ito, paano yung, how would you drill those facts and facts into the minds of his supporters?
You have
kasi, hindi, kasi po ito, ito yung reality sa social media especially. Miski sabihin niyo hard facts na yan, ang sagot sa inyo, BBM pa rin kami, Marcos pa rin. Kahit ano pang sabihin niyo, wala kaming pakialam, gawa-gawa lahat yan.
Oh, di wala tayong gagawa. If we cannot resolve it this way, then there's nothing we can do about it. Then it's gonna be precedent. But we have first to try to show the people, or at least 25% of the people, that this is what really happened during martial law. So forget Bongbong. You hit the father. And when the father goes down, Bongbong will go down, I assure you.
Kaso nga, yan, that's one perspective. Pero sinasabi po dyan, Senator, is ang claim nila, this is their narrative, the sins of the father should not visit upon the children.
Well, how can you say that? He's done nothing. He has done absolutely nothing. And he's always saying that he will correct what his father did. How can he correct what his father did? How can he correct the 3,200 people that he killed, or the 24,000 people that were tortured, or the 70,000 who were detained? But that's nothing. You think of the people from 1980 to 1986 who really suffered under martial law because the prices of goods went so high and they were left with nothing. That is what we have to tell the people. Now, if they don't believe us, fine, well and good. You go and vote for him. But I'll bet you several people will start to believe us because we have facts. We have facts to show that these things really happened. And, you know, how can you say you're going to correct what you're going to correct 55% poverty rate in 1984, 85, and 86? How will you correct that now? Ang daming nagutom noon.
Yeah.
Ang daming nahimatay noon.
For example, ito, yung last week we were speaking with one of his supporters, si Mayor Luis Chavez Singson. We were providing all the hard facts. Ang sagot niya, gawa-gawa lang lahat-lahat yan. And then si Bongbong Marcos at ang kanyang pamilya, biktima raw ng disinformation. Which actually boggles the mind dahil sila yung may napatunayang ninakaw na limpak-limpak na salapi sa kaba ng bayan. And then now, sila yung biktima. I mean,
that's why.
Why did we come to this?
I'm telling you, they're trying to foment a narrative that is not in keeping with what the truth is, and we have to tell them what the truth is. Alam mo naman, you know how much money they stole. All right, $5-10 billion. It's still a lot of money. All right. Now, up to now, we still have to recover about $1.5 billion from them. And we cannot do anything with the courts, these crazy courts. They just keep on postponing and postponing and postponing. Imelda was already found guilty. Yet she's out free.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's an example lang. Yung $600 million na nakuha natin sa
Swiss deposits.
Sa Chris Credit Bank. What was she doing with that money? So, I mean, you know, sabi gawa-gawa lang yan. Hindi. It's there. It's on paper. The court decided that it was stolen money and returned it to the Philippines.
Yeah, more than $680 million po. Yeah. Dollars.
That's dollars.
Okay, hindi po yan pesos. And of course, huwag kalimutan na iba, Bongbong Marcos is the executor of his father's estate.
Yes.
So meron siya talagang connection. Okay.
So, ang sinasabi ni Bongbong ganito, what am I supposed to say sorry for? Am I supposed to say sorry for the thousands of kilometers of roads that my father built? Or am I supposed to say sorry that we were self-sufficient in rice, which we were not, huh?
Mm.
Am I supposed to apologize for the power generation? What power generation? We were short already of power. And we had the highest literacy rate in Asia. We never had the highest literacy rate in Asia. We never had the highest. Mm. But, you know, so I will ask him, what you have to apologize for? You apologize to those millions of coconut farmers that you bled dry and you caused to go broke. You apologize
Coco levy.
Because of the cocoa levy.
Yeah.
You apologize to the hundreds of thousands of sugar planters who went broke because of your stupidity. You apologize to the people you put in jail. I mean, hey, Marcos can do that now, but he's not doing that. He says he will correct it when he's president. No, he should apologize now.
Okay. Ito, we're winding down now. We don't have much time now. Are you going to play an active role in the campaign of Leni Robredo?
Yes, I will.
Like what? What will be your role?
I don't know. We have strategy sessions.
Okay. Because in this case, we're talking of 60% support for Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. And your candidate is in far second with 16%. Has he become unbeatable? If not, how do you make your candidate win?
I make my candidate win by bringing Bongbong down first.
And then?
No, after you bring Bongbong down, all those other candidates will go up.
Yeah, but the top second choice is Isko Moreno.
Well, it's okay. As long as Bongbong doesn't win.
Okay. But in this case, what do you see in the Leni Robredo campaign which you think is not exactly working and perhaps needs tweaking?
Because they're not hitting Bongbong. I mean, they're not hitting the father. They should hit the father, not Bongbong. They're hitting Bongbong. So Bongbong, nakatiwangwang lang dyan, pero what, me? Who? What did I do? Well, of course, it's his father. So you hit the father first.
Okay. Former Senator Sir Chusmeña, thank you very much for joining us tonight on the program, sir.
Thank